Kia ora. Today we are in Victoria University in Wellington, New Zealand, and I am with Jamie Howarth, my ex-colleague and good friend.
Kia ora koutou, my name's Jamie Howarth. I'm a paleoseismologist and a senior lecturer here at Victoria University, and I'm excited to be here and talk to you a little bit about the work we've been doing on the Alpine Fault, and in particular how that work informs the likelihood that we're going to see a large earthquake on that fault in the future.
Now, my understanding of the Alpine Fault is it's a globally significant fault line that generates very large earthquakes potentially. And so, of course, it's really important for scientists to understand how often does that happen? When were the last earthquakes? How big were they? And that research has occupied many people for a long time in a very difficult environment, because the Alpine Fault crosses an alpine region in New Zealand. It's very inaccessible. There's lots of dense forests, wild, remote areas in New Zealand. It's quite hard to get information. And that's what's so interesting about what Jamie's been doing, because he's been able to sort of, in spite of those conditions, find out some really important information about the Alpine Fault. So, Jamie, I'm going to hand over to you, and you're going to take us through some of the way you've done your research, first of all, and then what you've found out over time because of your methods and your approach, and what that means for us.
Fantastic. So from space, the Alpine Fault is a very obvious and really straight feature that basically cuts through the South Island. It's a plate boundary fault, so it forms the boundary between the Pacific Plate in the east and the Australian Plate in the west. And it's a particular type of plate boundary. It's a transform plate boundary. And that basically describes the sense of motion between these plates. The Pacific Plate is actually moving southwest relative to the Australian Plate, which is moving northeast. Now, that plate motion is accommodated elastically. So that means that the fault is stuck and it's building up the stress associated with that plate motion, that it's continuous.
So that it's building up, then suddenly it's released in a big earthquake.
In a big earthquake. Okay. And we can see the Alpine Fault runs from offshore at Milford Sound, north along the base of the Southern Alps, through the central upper South Island, where it does a little bit of a dog leg before running offshore at Cloudy Bay near Blenheim.
Okay, so there is a little bit of upward movement then on the fault to produce the mountains, but it's not all upward.
There is a component of vertical motion or compression, and it's that compression which has built the topography that we see as the Southern Alps.
Okay. Let's start with what was previously known before you did your work here about the fault and where that was studied.
So a really famous record of past earthquakes on a fault, actually anywhere in the world, comes from the very southern onshore part of the Alpine Fault, from these sites called John O'Groats and Hokuri Creek. And if we zoom in to John O'Groats, I can explain why these are such good sites for recording earthquakes. So we can see the stream here that is running across the Alpine Fault. And what happens when we have a large earthquake is that this stream is offset and essentially dammed. And as a result of that damming, we have water and sediments spilling out over this wetland. And earthquakes are recorded then as interbedded sediment layers in the stratigraphy of this wetland that alternate between sediments produced by the river and sediments produced by the wetland itself.
Okay, so some of it will be kind of rocky material, gravel, sand, that sort of thing?
Yep, so that would be an earthquake interbedded with very organic material formed by the little plants that grow on the wetland. By using sediment cores that basically act as a time machine going back through time, we're able to identify those layers, date them with radiocarbon dating, and produce a history of large earthquakes on the fault. And we've been able to do that at these two sites, John O'Groats and Hokuri Creek, slightly to the north, over a time frame that spans the last 8,000 years, or 24 Alpine Fault earthquakes. So here we have a plot of the timing of the last 24 earthquakes on the Alpine Fault. So on the x-axis here, we have time in calendar years. So the present day is all the way to the right of the screen, and then we go back to around about 8,500 years ago. And then each one of these distributions you see here is our estimate for the timing of an earthquake. And one of the really neat things about this record is that the historic record spans this tiny little area right up at the right-hand end of the plot. So we're able to actually look at the recurrence of these earthquakes over a really long time frame, and that gives us a lot of confidence that we actually understand how this fault behaves. There is around about 300 years between each of these events, and that timing between events is pretty constant as we go back over the record.
So 300 years, and the last earthquake was?
In 1717, around about 300 years ago.
Okay.
Yeah.
What does that mean, just from this information, what does that mean about the probability of an earthquake, let's say, in the next 50 years?
Yeah, well, so because we've got a really long record of earthquakes from this point at the southern end of the fault, we can use it to forecast the likelihood that we will see an earthquake at some time in the future. So the probability from this record of seeing an earthquake at this site on the Alpine Fault is around about 29% in 50 years. So we can be reasonably confident that we can forecast when the next event is likely to occur here. But what we really want to know is how much of the fault breaks during those earthquakes and whether or not the forecast from here is applicable along the length of the fault.
Right, because there could be a place way up north where there's a different record because the earthquakes were not the same.
Exactly. As it turns out, lakes adjacent to the Alpine Fault provide really excellent archives of past earthquakes. So the cool thing about these lakes is that they were formed when glaciers retreated at the end of the last glacial maximum, sometime around about 17,000 years ago, and they've been archiving the processes that occur in this environment ever since then, okay, in the sediments that accumulate at the bottom.
Okay, so the ice retreats, yep. There's an empty basin filled with water, and then sediments slowly pile up at the bottom of those lakes for the last 17,000 years.
Yeah, yeah. And what's really interesting, when the Alpine Fault ruptures in a large earthquake, we generate strong ground motions. Yeah, they disturb the sediments or the natural pattern of accumulation in a way that allows us to recognise that a shaking event has occurred. And they do that continuously. So unlike that fault-bounded swamp that we were looking at John O'Groats in Hokuri Creek, the sediment archive or record that we're after is some 80 metres under the surface of this lake. And the way we actually sample it is using a Macarith Cora, which is a system that is lowered to the bottom of the lake, and we use compressed air to push a tube into the sediment that samples many thousands of years of accumulation, and then the whole thing lifts off. You can see in this video the Macarith Cora dramatically breaching the surface of the lake as it comes to the surface with our sediment archive or sediment record attached to it. Once we have that core, we take it back into the lab, split it, and then study it to identify these earthquake layers. The neat thing about lakes for reconstructing the spatial extent of earthquakes, they almost act like nature's seismographs. They're continuously recording. When there's an earthquake, they change the way the sediments are being laid down, and we can identify that, and then they continue recording. And one of the really powerful things about that is it means that they're able to record earthquakes that occur very closely spaced in time. And that's important because it means we can distinguish events that rupture one part of the fault from an earthquake that occurs in another part of the fault, but really closely spaced in time. So that's useful for starting to piece together this picture of rupture extent along the fault.
Great. So just a question. Let's say you've found a layer in the bottom of the lake. How do you date it? How do you know how old
so
it is?
So we use radiocarbon dating of leaf material from the vegetation that grows around the lake. Great. And we can determine the timing of an earthquake within a decade or so using these lake sediments.
Can you tell me a little bit more about the different lakes?
They're distributed along the entire length of the fault, and we've investigated four of them here. So here's that site that we talked about right at the southern end of the fault, and we've got really nice earthquake records from Lake Ellery, Lake Purringa, Maparihi you've seen, and Lake Canary up by Hokitika. And this allows us to put a picture together of earthquakes over the last 4,000 years along this 350 kilometre stretch of the Alpine Fault. But one thing I just want to bring to your attention is that while the Alpine Fault looks like this very straight linear structure, there are actually really important, albeit subtle, changes in the fault that occur along its length. And those changes are predominantly related to the strike of the fault, or the direction of it, and the dip of the fault, so the angle at which it's diving away into Earth's crust. For example, on the southwestern section here, which is a really important section with respect to some of the earthquake records we'll talk about, the fault, a subvertical dip, so it's almost straight up and down. And when we transition into the central section, which is also a really important section.
Which is the yellow section.
Which is the yellow section here. We have a much shallower dip, and it's dipping away to the east underneath the Southern Alps. And indeed, that change in the strike of the fault and the dip is what distinguishes the southwestern from the central section. And that will be important for the earthquake behaviour that we're about to talk about. Here we have a space and time diagram. So it's complicated, but I'll take you through it. And essentially what it's showing us is, unlike the last diagram when we just saw the timing of earthquakes going back through the last 8,000 years, this is showing us the timing, but also how much of the fault broke in each earthquake. At the bottom of the screen here, we have the Alpine Fault laying on its side such that north is to the left, and south is to the right. And then going vertically on the screen here, we've got time. So here's the year 2000, and we go back about 4,000 years in this record here. Each one of these red marks here is an Alpine Fault earthquake that has occurred at this particular site. Okay. And what we can do is, using statistics, we can correlate between sites, allowing us to map the spatial extent of rupture along this fault. The important take-home message to see from this is that where we have these red horizontal lines, we have these large magnitude 8 earthquakes that break the majority of the southwestern and central section of the fault, in excess of 320 kilometres. But what's really interesting is that there are other periods in the past, such as this one here demarked by these yellow earthquakes, where earthquakes rupturing the southwestern section or the central section actually stop at this location or the boundary between these two segments. And they have a much smaller magnitude, in the order of mid sevens as opposed to in excess of 8. So it's still a large earthquake, but the ground motions associated with a magnitude 8 that breaks in excess of 300 kilometres of the fault is going to be significantly greater, and the spatial extent of those significantly larger than magnitude 7. So distinguishing between the two is a really important thing to do. So based on this paleoseismic record alone, we are able to say that the central part of the Alpine Fault has a conditional probability, so a forecast of producing an earthquake in the next 50 years, of about 75%.
So that's dramatically different from 29%.
That is dramatically different from 29%.
Okay, so I'll just get this right. Yeah. You've discovered that the likelihood of an earthquake on the Alpine Fault central section has been, if you like, increased with this new information to 75% in the next 50 years. So it's pretty high.
Very high, yeah.
On a global level, what does that look like in terms of, is that big, high?
I would say that's very high. There are some faults that have higher conditional probabilities, but not many.
Okay.
Yeah.
What else can you tell me?
Well, what we can actually do is tell you what the magnitude or the amount of the fault that's going to break in the next earthquake. And we do that by combining our empirical observations of how the fault has behaved in the past with a computer model that's based on the physics of how earthquakes behave. And by bringing those two sources of information together, we can actually forecast not just the likelihood that we'll see an earthquake, but what its magnitude will be and what part of the fault will actually rupture.
Okay.
And what we see when we do that is there's about an 82% chance that the next earthquake is also going to be a magnitude 8 through-going rupture that breaks both the central and the southwestern section.
Okay. It feels very sobering, what you're saying, because what I'm hearing is that our understanding of the Alpine Fault now is telling us that the chances, all we can talk about is chances or statistics or probabilities, the probabilities or chances of a future earthquake on the Alpine Fault are higher that it will happen in the next 50 years than we thought, and that the fact that it's most likely going to be a magnitude 8 plus.
I think you've summarised it perfectly. The one thing that I will add is that I think knowledge is power in this instance, Julian. Now, at the end of the day, the fault, for all intents and purposes, is no more hazardous today than what it was yesterday before we knew about this information. But what we're able to do, knowing that there's a really high likelihood of a magnitude 8 earthquake on the Alpine Fault, is actually start to plan for it. And if we plan for it, we can build resilience into our communities and into our infrastructure.
Does it change anything in terms of, I'm a person living in a house somewhere on the South Island, potentially quite near to the Alpine Fault. Do I do anything different? What do I do about this?
I think as an individual, it doesn't really change that much at all. You know, we've had a spate of large earthquakes in New Zealand over the last decade, starting with the Christchurch earthquake sequence and then with Kaikoura. We all know what we need to do as individuals with respect to having our earthquake response plan for the household in place, making sure we have supplies in the house in the event that we are cut off from our supply lines. And really, I think that all this new information does is sharpen the point a little bit. It makes us just that little bit more aware, a little bit more conscious that we need to have those plans in place. And if we haven't done it, maybe it provides us with the encouragement we need to go out tomorrow or on the weekend and make sure that those supplies are stocked up, those water bottles have been refreshed, and that you sit down and have a corridor with your family about what your response plan is going to be in the event that you experience a large earthquake on the Alpine Fault, or indeed on any one of the other 500 or more active faults that we have in New Zealand.
So, Jamie, I'd like to really thank you. This has been an eye-opening discussion with you today. I think your work has been phenomenal. I've seen you in action. We've been in the field together. I've seen you working on getting those cores. It sounds easy. It's incredibly technical. It's really problem solving at its best in the most incredibly wild environments with all the weather and all of the wilderness around you. So fantastic. Thanks so much for this opportunity to hear about your research. And so I hope people at home have enjoyed, or if that's the right word, have felt enlightened. Something I'd really like to say too about it is, this is what science is. Science is value for society. We now have some insight which guides us and gives us really good information. So that's great. Thanks so much.
Yeah, thanks for coming along, Julian. As always, it's a pleasure discussing science with you. And I look forward to you taking their message out to the New Zealanders.
Great. All right.